So in the previous class we studied about the modern computer system, how it can be attached using something like how your operating system will act like an intermediary between. Okay. So in the previous class we understood about how modern computer system is being can be visualized or else can be structurized using your different operating system, and how your operating system can help each of these components to be paired with each other, connecting and performing so that you can get your tasks or your activities done. And also we checked out with revised out with an interrupt. Okay, interrupts. Okay, we saw about interrupt timeline, wherein we had a user process executing, okay, and even IO device executing. So when IO device will be executing, user process execution will be stopped, and when IO device is executing, so when user process is executing, IO device will be in the idle state. Okay, that is what up and downs, whatever in the cycles we saw in the previous class. So today we will start with the storage structure. Okay, so CPU can load instructions only from memory, or so any programs that run must be stored there. So general purpose computers run most of these programs from rewritable memory. So this is called as main memory. So rewritable memory in the sense what? Which can be rewritten. So for example, we can take it as a RAM. So random access memory. So it is a rewritable memory wherein I can even rewrite the content. So this RAM is also called as the main memory. So main memory commonly is implemented in a semiconductor technology. Okay, it is implemented in a semiconductor technology. So this is called as a dynamic random access memory. So dynamic in the sense what? At the particular time that is required, what is required, okay, whatever the data is required, that will be loaded. So rest of the things will be again eliminated. So dynamic, it changes according to the particular content or a particular situation or a particular execution of a task. Okay, so computer uses other forms of memory as well. Okay, so another form of memory in the sense what? Read only memory is there, that is we can say example as a ROM. Okay, so here in this ROM what happens, we can store the data, but it is that we cannot change the data. Okay, we cannot change the data, right? So for examples, some of the what is a read only memory, we can take as an example like EEPROM, EEPROM. Okay, EEPROM is this here, we cannot change whatever the data frequently, and so it contains only the static program. Static program in the sense what? Whatever the content that is not required to be changed according to different situation or different whatever the tasks what we are executing. So it is static. Static in the sense what? It is suitable for all the types of data. Okay, all the types of different programs that will be executed. So one of the example we can say, smartphones have EEPROM to store their factory installed programs. Factory installed program in the sense what? We are going to reset the smartphone. Suppose like we have taken a new smartphone. So default factory settings will be there with your smartphone, and once after you start using your smartphone, you install different softwares, you install different applications. So once these applications start running, maybe at some time your smartphone may go very slow due to some due to the installation of softwares that may even make your smartphone go slow. So at a time what you will do, you will reset your smartphone. Okay, so the instructions what are being required to reinstall or reset to the factory programs, so these type of programs are stored in the ROM. Okay, these type of programs are stored in the ROM. So these type of settings, they are not required to be changed. Okay, they are not required to be changed, they will be fixed, right? So at that time ROM will be used. This is one of the examples. Okay. So all forms of memory provide an array of words. So each word has its own address. Okay. So interaction is achieved through a sequence of load or store instructions. Please listen carefully. I am talking about load and store. I hope you remember about load and store instructions, assembly level instructions in the previous subject, that is your computer organization. So actually what happens during the time of a load, what happens during the time of a store, I am going to speak it now. Okay, please listen carefully. Okay, so each word has its own address and interaction is achieved through the sequence of load and store instructions to some specific memory. So the load instruction moves a word from main memory to the internal register within the CPU. So what does the load instruction will do? Load instruction will make the word to move from, make the bit of word to move from main memory to the internal storage within the CPU. Okay, whereas the store instruction moves the content of a register, okay, moves the content of register to the main memory, right? So what does the load instruction will do? It will make the word to move from main memory to the internal register within CPU, whereas store instruction moves the content of the register to the main memory, right? So in future we may use these instructions irrespective of whatever that is. Okay, so once we use this, then again you need to remember, so what does this load and store instruction will do? Okay, right. So aside from explicit load and store, CPU is also able to automatically load instruction from main memory for execution sometime, some typical time. So not only once the load or store instructions will be executed, not only at this time, some other time also a situation arises wherein the instructions will be transferred from either main memory or either from the registers for execution. So at the time you can say just like a task is executed based on priority based. Okay, a task is executed as on based on the priority based, and for a task to be executed which is based on the priority, of course you know what kind of instructions has to be executed. So there should be a made of a system call. So why do we use a system calls? To impose the interrupts, right? So you know types of interrupts also. Why do we really require the interrupts to be imposed, right? Okay. So typical instruction execution cycle as executed on the system first fetches an instruction from main memory and stores that instruction in the instruction register. The instruction is then decoded and may cause operands to be fetched from memory and stored in some internal register. So after the instruction on the operands has been executed, the result may be stored back in the memory. Okay, so here you can notice that the memory units see only the stream of memory addresses. It does not know actually how they are generated. Okay, like indexing will happen, how literally addresses will be provided, or some other means. Okay, or what they are for, like what they are being generated for. So accordingly we can ignore how a memory address is generated by a program. So for now we will ignore this. In future, in upcoming topic, in the upcoming classes, I will definitely tell you how these memory addresses are generated and why it is the particular address that is being taken for a particular storage and what type of storage actually we follow. Okay, right, we'll discuss about it. So we are interested only in the sequence of memory addresses generated by a particular present running program. So ideally we want a program and the data to reside in the main memory permanently. So this arrangement actually is not possible due to some reasons. So what might be the reasons? Okay, so first reason is that the main memory is very small. Okay, so main memory, what I told, it is something like we can imagine through a RAM. So I hope you can understand the RAM size is what size in each configuration of the system. So maximum the average systems what is being used at the home or else by the particular engineers at so like what you all use. So maximum RAM storage will be something what average RAM size will be 4 GB, right? So whenever I do execute any program or any task, first I need to get it through the main memory. Then by storing the content in the main memory, then I need to execute. That is the process actually. Okay. So suppose you think like a particular file is there which is of a 6 GB size, and your RAM is 4 GB size. So how can you possibly think like how we can do further? How we can go further for executing 6 GB of file within a 4 GB of memory space? So that is what impossible task. Okay, so this is what sometimes we may get like a situation wherein main memory will be getting it will be very small to execute a program. Okay, next, a main memory is volatile also. You know, volatile means what? Once the electric signals are been disconnected, or if we stop providing electric signals to the computer system, so the content stored in the main memory that will be eliminated. So it means what? Once the current supply has been disconnected, the content in the main memory is eliminated. So this is what the volatility. So since the main memory is volatile, the device, the storage devices will lose its contents when power is turned off. Okay. So thus, most computer system provides secondary storage for at this place. So most of the computer systems will use secondary storage as an extension of main memory. Okay. So how the main memory will take support of extension with the secondary storage? Of course, we had a very dedicated module there available in the next upcoming classes. We will discuss about that. So there wherein we will discuss about a disk management, and we will see how this 6 GB file can be executed within a 4 GB memory space that is in the RAM. So that how this impossible task can be made possible. Okay, right. That we will understand. That we will understand in the future upcoming classes. Right. So we have a dedicated module there for the disk management. Okay. Right. So main requirement for secondary storage is that it is able to hold a large quantities of data per minute. That is what the application, why we go for secondary storage. And since this secondary storage that is an extension of main memory, it will even also stores large content. Also it is a non-volatile. It means what? We can store the data, or it can be made available even though if current supply has been put off. Okay. Current supply is being put off. So this is what the application of the secondary storage, right? So the most common secondary storage device is one of the example we can take like a magnetic disk. So here, which provides storage for both programs and data. So most programs, like you can say like system and application programs, are stored on the disk until they have been loaded into the memory. Once if a program is to be executed, so it will be made to move from the secondary storage device to the main memory, and then within the main memory it will be executed. So hence, a proper management of a disk storage is of central importance. Right? So due to this activity. Okay. So in larger sense, once we think, so however, the storage structure that we have in our mind, something like that, you can just imagine this is what storage structure that we will talk like. This is what a storage hierarchy here. So how actually these disks are being utilized, like from lower level to the higher level, I will just come back to this diagram once again. Okay, so how this storage structure can be visualized, and how these components are been arranged, we are just going to discuss about this on this topic. So main memory magnetic disks is only one of many possible storage systems that we already know. So other even include like cache memory is there, okay, CD ROMs are there, okay, then magnetic tapes are there, and even so many other devices are there, like pen drives are there, portable memory storage devices are there, where you can use USB technologies there, right? So each storage system provides basic functions of storing a data and holding the data until it is been retrieved at the later time. Okay, so the main differences among the various storage system, it depends on like we can say the speed, cost and volatility. Okay, so the data that is we are storing in different types of secondary storage devices. So with a pen drive we can experience high speed, and even the cost for a pen drive you can imagine like it is very high. So once we compare with the another such type of portable storage devices, so speed may be compromised, but cost can be taken as an average, whereas in the case of volatility, even pen drive can be holding the data like permanently, and even the other storage devices will also hold the data permanently. Other than that, mostly the criteria will be just checked out with the speed and cost every time, or most of the time. Okay, right. So the wide variety of storage systems in a computer system can be organized in a hierarchy. So that is what you can see in the diagram. So like this, we can make the storage systems in a computer system to be arranged in this hierarchy order. Okay, so that is what you are seeing in the figure now. So this hierarchy is made arranged as according to whatever just now we talked about, the speed and cost. Okay, so the higher levels are expensive, but they are very fast. Higher levels are expensive, but they are very fast. As we move down the hierarchy, higher level in the sense what? This is what the resistors, cache, main memory. These are all what? These are all very high costs. Okay, they are very high costs as compared. They are even faster than compared to the lower levels. Fine. Okay. As we move down the hierarchy, the cost per bit generally decreases. So resistors. So that is what you can see on your motherboards. You have some small resistors, diodes, and all. So each resistor has its own application. So one of the resistor may act like a stack resistor, or it might act like arrays of resistors. It might act like something what a heap of dumping some data in the resistors. So I hope you might understand what I'm talking. So already this has been discussed in the computer organization subject once we were studying that computer organization subject. Okay, right. So in fact many early storage devices whatever were there, like including paper tape and some core memories or like semiconductor memory. So before the semiconductor memory was introduced, so earlier there were many other devices that used to store the data. So these all were being reformed, and once the semiconductor technology was introduced, so these were reformed, and they become very faster and cheaper. So whatever you can see, the top four levels of memory, so these are all what? Very faster, but very costly when compared to the lower levels of types of memory. So in addition, we can say like to the differing in speed and cost, the various storage systems are either, we can say like a volatile and non-volatile. So as mentioned earlier, volatile storage loses its contents when power to the device is removed. So in absence of expensive battery and generator backup systems, the data must be returned to the non-volatile storage. That is what we can keep our data safe. Okay, so in hierarchy, whatever that you are seeing on the screen, the storage systems above the electronic disk are volatile. So whatever that you are seeing, the storage systems above this electronic disk, like main memory, cache memory and resistors, these are all what? Volatile. Okay. So whereas those below are non-volatile. So below this electronic disk, like magnetic disk, optical disk and magnetic tapes, these are all what? Non-volatile. Okay. So during normal operation, the electronic disk stores the data in a large that is what, dynamic RAM array, so which is again a volatile only. So but many electronic devices contains a hidden magnetic hard disk, okay, at the back end, and a battery backup for a backup power, like to have some instructions to be executed once any interrupt will occur. Okay, so if external power is interrupted, the electronic disk controls copies of data from RAM of the magnetic disk. So when external power is restored, the controller copies the data back into the RAM. Another form of electronic disk that we can say this type of disk as an example is a flash memory, or else we can say like a PDAs, personal data assistants. Okay. So specifically these types are used in robots, manufacturing of robots. So robots, once we do give any instruction, right, once we give an instruction, they will do execute based on those instruction factors. So if there is a sudden power failure with the robotic system, so the instructions whatever been given in the previous, so that will be stored in this way. Okay, so once it is been what is that restored, so they will again get the instructions from these DRAMs array, and they will start executing the same instructions from the previous what they stopped, right? Okay. So the design of complete memory system must balance all factors, as what we discussed just now. So it must use only as much expensive memory as necessary while providing as much inexpensive. Okay, right. So this is what. So next, what we are going to check out is with the computer system architecture, right? Okay. So most systems that whatever we use now, whatever we are using, so they can be said like single processor units, like multiprocessor units, or very tightly processed units. It might be asymmetric, or it might be symmetric, or multitasking, we can say. Okay, so in generally we can imagine a computer system to be a single process in general. Okay, so something like, for example, a mainframe computer system, so what we can imagine. Okay, so these are called as a single processor systems. So most system use a single processor. So the variety of single processor systems may be, however, since these systems range from PDAs through mainframes on a single processor system, there is one main CPU capable of executing general purpose instruction set, including instructions from the users. So how can we imagine this single processor or a general purpose system, this diagram? Okay, so this is a von Neumann architecture. So wherein we can see that a CPU consists of a single processor will just execute like whatever instruction for a regular system to be used. Okay, so almost all systems have other special purpose processes as well. So they may come in the form of a device specific processor, such as a disk, okay, a keyboard, or a graphics controllers, what we can say, or even mainframes. They may come in the form of more general purpose processes, such as IO processes that move data rapidly from the components of the system. So all of these special purpose processes run at a limited instruction set and do not run user processes parallelly. Okay, sometimes they are managed by the operating system. In that, operating system sends them information about their next task and monitors the status. Okay, so for example, we can say like a disk controller microprocessor receives a sequence of requests from the main CPU and implements its own disk queue and scheduling algorithms. So this arrangement reveals the main CPU of overhead of a disk scheduling. Overhead means what? Delays, whatever we can say. Okay, delays, whatever we can say. Fine. So this arrangement reveals the main CPU of the overhead. So actually, the PCs, the program counters, whatever I just told about disk controller. So this can be taken as an example, like a program controller. So this program controller, or as process controller, this contains a microprocessor in a microprocessors. Like for example, we can imagine like a keyboard as an example. So this is used in keyboard to convert a keystrokes into codes to that is to be sent to the CPU. So codes in the sense what? In the form of electronic pulses, that is in the form of zeros and ones. Okay, so zeros and ones. So in other systems or circumstances, special purpose processors are used, like low level components which are built on the hardware. Okay, so the operating system cannot communicate with these processes. They do their jobs autonomously, okay, on their own. So each component of the system knows its own job. Now you can say there is a direct connection between memory and device. So this device, you can assume like a input output device. So it is connected to the memory using a DMA controller. So DMA means what? Order we studied about a DMA. What is the long form of DMA? Direct memory access. Okay. So direct memory access in the sense what? Whatever the device wants to execute, so it can utilize the instructions from the memory to be executable directly. Okay. There is no require of the CPU to be intervened in between. So if the instruction pass from the device to the CPU and then from the CPU to the memory, I know I hope you remember that this cycle of instruction transfer will take more time to be executable, other than directly making a device to execute or executing instruction with the memory using a DMA controller. I hope you remember about that. Fine. Okay. So the use of special purpose microprocessors is common and do not turn a single processor system into a multiprocessor. So there is only one general purpose CPU, then the system is so we can imagine like a single processor system. So once this is next system, what we can see is or assume is a multiprocessing architecture. So multiprocessing architecture, we can say like a memory is connected to different number of CPUs. So multiprocessing, so each CPU will be having its own processor, and the number of systems attached with the same memory device which is sharing between them. So here we can talk like a multiprocessing architecture. Okay. So although a single processor system are most common, so multiprocessor system, these are also known as the parallel systems. So these are very tightly coupled systems, as because you can see the diagram how they are tightly coupled, and these are what of very importance as accordingly compared with the single processor system. So wherein each CPU is having only one processor, so only single CPU is available. So such systems have two or more processors in close communication, sharing the computer bus and sometimes the clock, or else you can say like a memory and even the peripheral devices. Okay, so the multiprocessor systems can have three main advantages. So first advantage, what is that? Increased throughput. So increased throughput means what? The number of processes or number of tasks that can be executed at a particular set of time, how many number of tasks are executed, that is what I call as a throughput. Okay, next is economy of a scale in the sense what? As and all the number of programs we can execute at the same time. Okay, so the cost factor will reduce. I hope you can understand. It depends on the time, CPU time that is being utilized. Okay, CPU time that is utilized, and whatever is that, in the sense what resources, number of resources that can be utilized at the same time. So since multiple CPUs are there available, as accordingly the number of resources will increase. Okay, so this even we can say like economy of scale. Then increased reliability. Reliability in the sense what any of the component will stop working, we can reliable on other component. Okay, suppose the CPU is zero, it stops working due to some uncertain conditions. So there is availability of another two systems, that CPU 1 and CPU 2. So whatever the data that was being executed, that is again can be reliable on the either of the CPU 1 or CPU 2, whichever will be free. And whatever the resources what was being previously utilized by CPU 0, these again can utilize the same number of resources available with the different CPUs. Okay, so these are the three main advantages what makes a multiprocessor system to be utilized in the most cases other than compared to the single processor systems. So what are those advantages? Increased throughput, economy of a scale, and increased reliability. Okay, these three factors. Fine. Next. Next, other than these multiprocessing architecture, other than this multiprocessing architecture, we can also go for a dual core design. Okay, dual core design in the sense what? Again, it is a multiprocessing system only. As that we can see, there are two different systems available, two different CPUs available. But again, we can say we as a core component to be in the sense. As the core component to be in the sense, from the outer view we will assume like it is only one single CPU available, and inside we have two different cores. We can see here core 0 and core 1. Okay, these two different cores will act like a single CPU. Okay, you can see the diagram, there is one single CPU what we can observe from the outside, but actually how the core design is done? Core design is done such that again each core will act like a single CPU system. So that is what called as a dual core design within a single processor system. This is what a single processor system we studied in the previous. So this is one CPU. So this CPU, this is having only one core system now. So if I do divide the cores into two, so here core 0 and core 1. So this here we can assume like a dual core design, dual core design. Okay. I hope only 1 minute is remaining right now. So we will come back. Okay, so we were discussing about the dual core design, as I told. So within a single CPU, we will imagine two dual cores. So earlier in the single processing system, there was only one core CPU. Now we can assume like two different core of CPU. So CPU core 0 and CPU core 1. So each core will act like a single CPU system. Okay, so each core will act like a single CPU system. So what are the advantages? We can share the registers. Again, that we can imagine from the multiprocessor systems, like increased throughput, economy of a scale, increased reliability. So that all can be imagined with this dual core design. So as accordingly what the figure you are observing on the screen. Okay. So a dual core design with the two cores on the same chip we can observe. So in this design each core has its own register set, as we can see. So as well as it has its own local cache memory. Okay, cache memory is what very important, as we know that what are the applications of cache. So here let us revisit back what are the different applications of the cache. So cache memory is used to copy the data, small amount of data, very faster. Okay, very faster. So, and it will be stored temporarily for temporary sessions. So that one of the example where you can imagine like a cache memory is utilized is your live streaming content, like the YouTube's what you will do observe. Okay, so there we will use the cache memory. So here it is used to store the content very faster, and it will be checked very faster. Okay, right. So cache is smaller than the storage being that is being available. Okay, so cache memory is something what only a part of the instruction will be stored. It's not like a whole video will be stored within the cache memory, not like that. A part of the instruction that is to be executed next, that will be stored in the cache memory. Okay, that will be stored in the cache memory. So once that instruction is executed, so cache memory will be resetted. It will be kept on resetted. Okay, that is what. Don't worry about regarding. We will discuss in more depth for cache memory once we will go for CPU scheduling algorithms. There, of course, we will discuss about the cache memory, how at the back end, how your cache memory will behave by bit we will understand later on. Okay, so we were talking about a dual core design. So each core will be having its own cache memory, as you can see on the screen. Okay, so other designs might use a shared cache or a combination of a local or a shared caches. So other designs other than this dual core, they may use a shared cache memory, like input-output devices are there. So DMA controller will be having a cache memory, so that will be shared among different I/O devices. Okay, so like that it will happen. So there is an application of shared I/O content, that is a shared cache content. Okay, so aside from architectural considerations such as the cache memory and bus content, these multi-core CPUs appears on operating system as N standard processes. Okay, so this tendency puts pressure on operating system designers and application programmers to make use of those CPUs. So finally, we can say like a server systems are there, maximum they will go with these type of a dual core designs. Okay, so here multiprocessor boards, IO boards and networking ports are placed in the same chassis. Like in this dual core design, what will happen, this IO different IO processing units or boards which will control these IO devices, like what the DMA controller is there available. Okay, like that. So multiple these things will be there available, so that since two different CPU we can assume in the same frame, so accordingly the number of core systems will increase. So we need to provide a more number of components so that we can make that provide a good performance. Okay, right. So actually the difference between these and the traditional multiprocessor system is that each processor board boots and independently and run its own operating system. So some of these boards are multiprocessors as well, so which blurs the lines between the types of computers. So in sense, these servers consist of the multiple independent multiprocessor systems. Okay, so in the servers. Okay, so if one server will fail, the other server will be there as a backup, so that will help you to get yourself served with the content whatever you are requesting for. Okay, that is what. So if one core system will get some improper working, so it might depend on the other core system. Okay, so even though once we can imagine in more depth way, each core system can be again imagined like a multiprocessor system wherein it is again having its own deep different structurization. Okay, so such things we will study in the clustered system. Okay, such things we will again further discuss more in the clustered systems. So this clustered system we are going to discuss in the next class. As of now the time is more, I request Mr. CR to please provide me the attendance. Okay, and I hope you have your next classes scheduled at 10 o'clock. Okay, so fine, we will stop it here and we will learn about the clustered systems in the next class.